All right, so here's how we're going to look at this. So as you may recall, in this housing example, if we look at different degrees of polynomials and how well they fit the data, let's look at the training error, the per example training error. So how far off is it for each of the data points? And as we increase the degree of the polynomial from constant to linear to quadratic and all the way up to, well, in this case, order 6, the error is always falling. As you go up, you have more ability to fit the data closer and closer and closer, right? Because each of these models is nested inside the other. We can always go back. If 0 fits best, and I give you 6 degrees of freedom, you can still fit the 0. So that's what happens with the training error. But now let's use this idea of cross-validation to say, what if we split the data up into chunks and have each chunk being predicted by the rest of the data? Train on the rest of the data, predict on the chunk, repeat that for all the different chunks, and average together. So I actually did that. And this is what I got with the cross-validation error. So there's a couple interesting things to note about this plot. So we see have this red plot that is constantly falling, and the blue plot, which is the cross-validation error, starts out a little bit higher than the red plot that's got higher error. So why do you think that is, Charles?
Well, that makes sense, right? Because we're actually training to minimize error. We're actually trying to minimize error on the training set. So the parts we aren't looking at, you're more likely to have some error with. So it makes sense that you'd have a little bit more error on the data you haven't seen.
Right. So good. So on this red curve, we're actually predicting all the different data points using all of those same data points. So it is using all the data to predict that data. This blue point, which is really only a little bit higher in this case, is using, in this particular case, I used all but one of the examples to predict the remaining example, but it doesn't have that example when it's doing its fitting. So it's really predicting on a new example that it hasn't seen, and so of course you'd expect it to be a little bit worse. In this particular case, the averages are all pretty much the same, so there's not a big difference. But now let's look what happens as we start to increase the degree. We've got the ability to fit this data better and better and better. And in fact, down at, you know, say 3 and 4, they're actually pretty close in terms of their ability to fit these examples. And then what's great, what's really interesting, is what happens is now we start to give it more, the ability to fit the data closer and closer. And by the time we get up to order 6 polynomial, even though the error on the training set is really low, the error on this cross-validation error, the error that you're measuring by predicting the examples that you haven't seen, is really high. And this is beautiful. This inverted U is exactly what you tend to see in these kinds of cases, that the error decreases as you have more power, and then it starts to increase as you use too much of that power. Does that make sense to you?
It does make sense. So the problem is that as we give it more and more power, we're able to fit the data, but as it gets more and more and more power, it tends to overfit the training data at the expense of future generalization.
Right, so that's exactly how we refer to this, is this sort of idea that if you don't give yourself enough degrees of freedom, you don't give yourself a model class that's powerful enough, you will underfit the data. You won't be able to model what's actually going on, and there'll be a lot of error. But if you give yourself too much, you can overfit the data. You can actually start to model the error, and it generalizes very poorly to unseen examples. And somewhere in between is kind of the Goldilocks zone, where we're not underfitting and we're not overfitting, we're fitting just right. And that's the point that we really want to find. We want to find the model that fits the data without overfitting and not underfitting.
So what was the answer on the housing example?
Well, so it seems pretty clear in this plot that it's somewhere, it's either 3 or 4. It turns out if you look at the actual numbers, 3 and 4 are really close, but 3 is a little bit lower. So 3 is actually the thing that fits it the best. And in fact, if you look at what 4 does, it fits the data by more or less zeroing out the quartic term, right? It doesn't really use this power.
But that's interesting. So that means it barely uses the extra degree of freedom you give it, but even using it a little bit, it still does worse in generalization.
Just a tiny bit worse. Yep, exactly.
That's actually kind of cool.